Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
That sounds like I've got some alive people in here. Let's give Jesus a real good clap now. Yes. Sharp-tempered, certainly. Let me just say it, because I'm upset. dreaming. But not quite there yet. You still, you speak it into his life. You pray it into his life. You call those things between loves as though they are. Like our children about Abraham. Abraham in verse 11. And Sarah. Now listen. When God came with the promise to Abraham to say he's going to have a child, Abraham got. Those of us who are a bit old know these things are impossible. Anybody? Yeah? To have a child at 99 is impossible. No? You all know that? Yes. Got some people out there? And so what happened? It says by faith, even Sarah herself, when barren, received power to conceive. We know as women, after a certain age, it's impossible. So even Sarah, when she was told by the angel, laughed. And it said, even though she was past her age, and she considered that the one who promised was faithful. Do you consider the one who promised is faithful? Do we consider him faithful? Yes. Is he faithful to you? Yes. Is he faithful to his word? Yes. And he's able to do beyond our imagination. That's the God we serve. That's the Christ. We were singing about the blood earlier, weren't we? The blood of Jesus. That blood means a lot. That cross means a lot. A lot more than just seeing a man hanging on like this. He's not even there anymore. He's not on the cross. Because the magnificent thing was he rose from the dead, didn't he? And now he's seated in heaven, and what's he doing? He's praying for you, all of us. He's making intercession for us. So the cross is not just about someone dying. The victory is in the fact that he rose from the dead. And he's now sitting at God's right hand, praying for us. That's the magnificent God that we serve. No other God is like him. No other God. He came back to me, not the grave. He's not there anymore. He's in heaven, interceding for each one of us. So if this thing, if no one's praying for you, you know Jesus right now is calling your name before the Father in heaven. Isn't that amazing? He knows your name. He knows your address. He has left you behind. He knows exactly if you think of someone that's in that world. That's a bit scary, isn't it? When we're not thinking good thoughts, God knows those thoughts. When we're thinking good thoughts, God knows those thoughts. If we're thinking good thoughts about him or somebody else, he knows those thoughts. And what we often think is what we speak. So that's why we have to be careful what we speak. Speak blessing, not curses over people. So we go back to Abraham and Sarah. And it says, therefore, further down, verse 12, and therefore, from one man, in fact, from one as good as dead, Abraham was it was impossible for him to have a baby. He was not producing seed. Okay? And Cain's offspring had numerous of the stars. If we look at the stars, as I say, I like looking at the stars. When I park my car outside my house every night, I love to look up at the stars. I just do it. I like to look at heaven. And in the countryside, where there's no street lights, you see more stars, don't you? When there's lots of street lights, I'm sure there's lots more street lights, and they're brighter in London than they are here. Yes? Much brighter. So I don't see as many. But I remember when I was in the Amazon jungle. Anybody know the Amazon jungle? Yes? I was in the jungle. And that night, I could not tell you before I had the stars I saw on the heavens. I saw shooting stars, I saw planets, I saw everything. And it's just amazing. And God took Abraham outside, as he is in Genesis 15, and he said, look up at the stars, and you're going to have that many children. And Abraham's standing there thinking, not that good. I can't produce everything at this age. I remember I once said to my dad was in his 80s, and died at 91. And I said, Dad, will you marry again? Because my mother died. He said, will you marry again? He smiled and laughed, and he said, worshiping God, just like Abraham. Abraham and God seemed to talk, didn't they? Isn't that amazing? That God himself wants to come talk to us as mere mortals. The important man of the universe, creator. I just love it. He finds time for you. Isn't that amazing? He finds time for you. And if you listen, he will talk to you in the inner man, a little voice that's giving you little thoughts or little ideas or certain scriptures as you read it. The words will just drop into your face. When I first became a Christian, that was the most amazing thing. When I was a non-Christian, I read the Word and it was born. When I became a Christian, wow, I opened up that Bible and let me tell you, it was as if the Word was jumping off the page at me. It was just speaking something I was thinking of, or I was doing, or I was about to do. It would talk back to me. So that came out of me, spending that time in the Scriptures and my relationship with God. You don't get to know somebody, do you, until you spend time with somebody. Luke, your best friend, did you spend lots of time together? Your best friend, that made that relationship so that you got to know one another. You liked even the funny bits that you saw, and you were put on well together. Isn't that so? Yes? So that is what we have to do in order to know God and know that you know that you know that he's real. That for me is the greatest thing about God. So in Genesis 15, when God took him outside and he said to him, you know, count the stars. He said, count the stars. And if you are able to count them, he said, so shall your descendants be. And that's where Abraham believed God. And in Romans 4:11, it says, he called those things which were not as though they are. So Abraham, what did Abraham do? He constantly confessed. He spoke what he knew and heard from God. You know, we have to speak the word. The word has to become life to us. There's a real lady. He's a girl of a girl last week in America. His mother. I tell you, they said that woman owed to die. They said to her, they said, you've just got a few weeks to live. You've got cancer. You can't do anything.